On today's episode of Bubs and the Bagger, the guys venture down another rabbit hole.
First of all, you owe me $4.99.
Oh, dear.
Because I had to rent this piece of shit.
T-Bag learns a hard truth.
I gotta say, the Old Milwaukees are tasting okay tonight.
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
And Bubs makes a heavy wager on the future of Minnesota.
I think the first time I touched myself, I then touched myself again.
Probably shortly thereafter.
All this, and even more Tom Cruise, coming up.
All right, everybody, welcome again. Welcome back, everyone, on this absolute intense sack stretcher of a day here at the Ponderosa Studios. Welcome to the Bubs and the Bagger Show. I'm the Bagger.
And Bubs.
Welcome, Bubs.
My sack is in full effect.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Steamy in here. We'll see how this show goes, guys.
I might take my shirt off. Michael Skins. You'll be in for a woolly mammoth.
The Johnny Cash shirt?
Yeah.
It's a lovely shirt you got on today. What's that you got there as a beverage of choice today?
Well, the stewardess brought over some airplane bottles. So I have Buffalo Trace whiskey. And I'm now pouring it on the ice that you provided me and my tumbler that I brought. Because you, as a bachelor, I'm unsure of your bar status, of what you have for drinking vessels.
I do have a few good whiskey glasses that are in good repair.
Okay.
If you need one in the future. Actually, a couple of really classy ones. But having said that, the one you brought is also very classy in and of itself. I believe that's kind of like what's known as like an old-fashioned glass or something. Or?
Sure. Manhattan Old Fashioned. This one is just whiskey on ice.
Sure. I'm going with that wonderful World of Leisure today. The usual 16-ounce Old Milwaukee. We're going to have a commercial spot, I believe, later from them today. That's
nice.
Going to be good.
Wow.
A few sponsors lined up today, which is good.
So. Yeah. That is still in negotiations with the team in Florida about the possible relocation.
Sure. We'll
see if they want to buy the team.
We're excited to hear the developments on that.
Yeah, yeah. They're going to move the team. I need some background on MacGruber because I think the SNL MacGruber was when? What years? What was that time frame for?
Okay,
Will Forte as a knockoff of MacGyver.
I'm guessing SNL MacGruber was probably like. From what I remember, I think Saturday Night Live MacGruber was probably like 2008-ish until, or maybe like 2005 to 2008 or 9. The movie came out in 2010. I believe it might have been either August or it might have been like spring. I can't remember exactly. But if you were lucky enough, you might have been able to see MacGruber in the theater for 1 week. That's about as long as it was in there for.
What attracted you to this character, this theme, this movie?
Nothing. Nothing whatsoever.
Okay.
One night I was at home probably a year and a half or 2 years after it was in the theater. It was on TV. I was too lazy to change it. And I got sucked in after probably the first, 10 minutes. And the rest is history. I was watching it saying, wow, this is really funny, much funnier than I thought it would be. And then, halfway through it, I said, this is probably the dirtiest Saturday Night Live movie I've ever seen, especially towards the end. There is a great deal of foul language. There's a great deal of sexual innuendo. And then towards the end of the film, there are a couple of love scenes that are highly erotic. Let's put it that way.
It's a matter of opinion. Matter of opinion.
The movie has definitely earned its R rating. I'm surprised it wasn't rated any higher than that.
Well, there just wasn't graphic sex.
I think even though there was no nudity for the most part, other than you did see a little bit of a bare male butt.
Well, buttocks. I don't think it was a little bit. There was a lot of male butt.
Yeah, you're right. There were a couple of other scenes. I'm talking about the love scene, though. There was like no nudity, but they did show at one point a male buttocks. But they did happen to show, they were covered in sheets, but they were very clearly having,
Well, I think the other love scene he made.
He was having sex with a woman on a grave. in a graveyard.
Well, she was a ghost, and he only saw her.
Right, but I mean, there was some vigorous movements with the hips.
And it was his ass.
It was.
He had tan lines. He's a littler fella, isn't he? Probably weighs 145. Probably,
he's a 32 medium.
Yeah. Slim. Slim cut.
He wore the slim fit rustlers in third grade or whatever.
All right, give me your top five things about this movie, or four things, or the one thing, or whatever.
Well, for me, I think the biggest thing that I liked about MacGruber was the chemistry. The cast obviously had a fun time making the movie. They enjoyed themselves. They were funny to watch. They were funny to listen to. I thought there were some montage scenes that were also very strong, where he selects his crew in the beginning. His crew of former guys that he was in the military with. Yeah,
they're all wrestlers.
For the record, MacGruber, they go through his backstory.
Navy SEAL.
He was
Green
a Navy
Beret,
SEAL, a
Green Army Ranger.
Green Beret, an Army Ranger. He had 12 Purple Hearts.
But never fired a gun.
Two Congressional Medals of Honor and God knows what else.
Yeah.
And he's sworn off violence now.
Yeah.
There's a gimmicky, sort of scene in the beginning where it's basically like Rambo 3, where a guy comes to his, Buddhist temple monastery to lure him out of retirement to go and, fight for the country again. And he won't do it. And then he finally kind of gives in to the colonel's demands, only once he realizes that his old girlfriend, Kristen Wiig, is somehow tied up in it or something like that. I can't exactly remember.
He recruits her for the team.
That's right, yeah.
She's making music in her living room.
Oh, the way that the colonel got him back was when he said that the perpetrator of everything, the guy who was stealing this military rocket, was Dieter von Kunth, who was the main villain and is played by Val Kilmer.
What was his last name?
Von Kunth.
With a C.
C-U-N-T-H, yes.
See you next Tuesday, H.
Yeah. So I cannot state this enough too. Val Kilmer, it's probably one of the best roles I've seen him do. I loved him in it. I couldn't get enough of Val Kilmer as Dieter von Kunth. He was the best villain I've ever seen. Bubs might not agree with me, but we're going to get to his thing in a moment here. So that's three things. Kilmer, the chemistry, the montages. I love the montage, too, like I was saying, where he picks his team, and it's a bunch of WWE guys who join him because they used to be on his, military. They were with him in the military. And MacGruber gets him recruited and then accidentally blows them all up a few minutes later. There are spoilers, but we don't give a fuck about that shit, so stick along for the ride. If you haven't seen MacGruber yet in 2023, that's your loss, not mine. Anyways, MacGruber at that point realizes he's on his own, so he recruits two people that he, one is a guy that is a military guy under him who he at first can't stand. That's played by Ryan Phillippe. Yeah, other than that, I like the music. And I also thought that for the what was obviously a very low budget, the film was shot pretty well. I thought it looked well for the amount of money that it cost them. And it was a sleeper hit for me, and it's become a cult classic with a lot of people my age over the last 10 or 15 years. I love MacGruber. There is not one person that was cast in the movie that I thought shouldn't have been there. I thought Powers Booth as the colonel was really, really good. I thought MacGruber, played by Will Forte, was obviously amazing. Kristen Wiig, great. Phillippe, great. Val Kilmer, by far probably my favorite character in the movie. And there's, a few other, a little bit of a who's who of some supporting cast that you might see. But
do you own the movie?
Yes.
All right. Is it my turn?
It is if you want it to be your turn.
Do you have more to add?
You
can fill in.
Yeah, I mean, why don't you give me what your 2 cents were, and then after that, we're going to strip down and fight.
Well, I'm slippery right now. So good luck getting a hold of me.
You're going to have to go
for the short hairs.
You and me both, sir.
Yes, short hairs. Well, you want me to give you my 2 cents worth? Well, first of all, you owe me $4.99.
Oh, dear.
Because I had to rent this piece of shit. Netflix or Prime or whatever the fuck we did. I mean, I know I can't get back time, the 98 minutes that I watched that, but the $4.99 you owe me, so that's a drink somewhere.
Roger that.
Otherwise, I thought it was going to be outstanding because in the opening scene, when they're doing like an opening scene montage and they're going through the confidential files and they list his skills, and a lot of it's redacted, you know, it says he like, you know, killer of multi whatever or something, and then it just says skilled lover.
Yeah.
I laughed out loud in his personnel file. Yeah.
And that's in the first like minute of credits.
Yeah.
And that was the last time you laughed?
Or? Well, there was a couple scenes, you know, with the music and then how it would just all of a sudden cut out. You know, it's like the 80s rock. And he always carried his car stereo with him. He took it out and he drove a red Miata.
His Blaupunkt. Yeah, he carried a Blaupunkt.
Yeah, I remember those. I remember the stereos. I had a friend that had the stereo. But anyway, you know, there's scenes. It was like little, basically like sketches that they did that were funny that they just pieced together that I thought some of it was funny. A lot of time I just sat there going, what the fuck? I didn't think Will Forte's character was funny barely at all. I mean, there was some funny shit, but
yeah.
Nothing really stuck out. I mean, I'm sure there were some scenes where I was laughing. The way his character was just, you know, it's obviously a mockery of MacGyver, and he fashions up a couple stupid things that don't work out of, you know, string and tape and glue and a paper clip or whatever. You know, it was just a mockery of that.
His Incredimop that he,
Well, and then his grenade.
His tennis ball hand grenade.
Yeah, it was a fizzle smoke grenade or whatever, but... I don't know. It didn't strike a chord with me as it did with you.
Gotcha.
Yeah. So that's it.
Well, you are entitled to your opinion, Bubs.
Thank you. I thought Val Kilmer was fine in it. Didn't matter. You could have probably cookie cut anybody in there. It seemed like he was laughing through his whole scenes. And then Powers Booth, though, he did a good job as the Colonel. And just that over the top, cartoonish Rambo Colonel coming to.
Damn you, Mac.
Yeah, he was. So that was good. I thought that was entertaining. But Will Forte's, I don't know, he was like schizoid in it half the time, and it was too much screaming.
Yeah.
Be funny, write a joke, don't scream.
Well, Bubs.
You know, if you're going to scream and scream and scream, well, then you got nothing to write, so write something funny.
I think there was some funny stuff in there. I think.
No, there was, but it wasn't.
For a guy who's seen it probably 20 times.
You'll never get that time back.
Well, I mean, I'm going to have to ask you to see it a second time. A little bit of a cool breeze in here, man.
Yeah, I don't know.
I won't ask you to see it a second time, Bubs. I honestly, I value your criticism. And if MacGruber wasn't your cup of tea.
Parts of it was.
I respect that. I really do.
I thought it was going to be phenomenal when the first scene was Skilled Lover. And I was ready. I was hooked. They hooked me.
I could tell when I had texted him a few times, like afterwards, I didn't get any response back, which I knew meant Bubs had either done one of two things. A, went to bed, or B, didn't like the movie. And in this case, it was probably both.
I thought I sent you one about a Bloody Mary and depression.
You did. Yeah.
And avoidance issues.
Yeah. Well, the good thing is this, Bubs, the next movie is all yours.
Ooh. All right.
I know we had talked loosely about a couple options, but... I'm going to leave it up to you, man. You know, I don't know if you have one on deck that you know of right off the top of your head right now.
Well, one just popped into my head. Oh, I didn't even give it any thought. Was Oliver Stone's JFK.
Ooh, interesting choice.
Just, you know, some layers. Might be timely for this time.
Stand by one sec, Bubs.
Are you...
I'm gonna just pull something up on this thing called the internet.
It's on your computer now, according to Homer Simpson.
And I'm going to just look at the cast of JFK because I hadn't seen it in a while. But.
Well, you got some people in there. Kevin Costner.
Yes.
Well, you got Joe Pesci. He was in there.
You know, for some reason, Bubs, I think I'm wrong on this, but for some reason, I thought the great Academy Award nominated actor. Who's also a fan of the show, was in that movie, James Woods, but he's not.
Well, another one that would be good. Wasn't his character in Casino something? Diamond? Johnny Diamond?
Lester Diamond. He was in maybe two scenes, and he stole the entire movie.
Yeah.
And that's including with De Niro and Pesci in those scenes.
Yeah.
So, that's a good one. But JFK is also strong. I'm going to leave it up to you. But now that I am looking at the cast of JFK, listen to this shit. This has got some people. Kevin Costner, Kevin Bacon, Tommy Lee Jones, Gary Oldman as Lee Harvey Oswald.
Oh, nice.
Michael Rooker, Sissy Spacek, Joe Pesci, Jack Lemmon, Walter Matthau, Donald Sutherland, Ed Asner, Brian Doyle Murray, John Candy, Sally Kirkland. For you younger people, you're not going to recognize a single name here. But for anyone over the age of 35, those are some pretty big heavyweights there. I haven't seen that movie in years. I'd love to see it again, though. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's actually a really good choice. And I do have that one on DVD.
Oh.
Yeah. So if you need to borrow it, it's all yours.
Or, yeah, we could have a viewing session. A sesh.
Yeah, both of us could, but...
We can't sit next to each other,
Courtney. No, I mean, we need to
on your love seat.
Sequester and then segregate and take our notes. And
so maybe you watch it, hand me the movie, I'll watch it.
Yeah, that and,
take
you know.
Notes. This one you'll have to take notes
I'll on. Maybe let you have one puff of my spliff.
Oh.
You know, but if you wanted it.
Yeah.
I got to say, the old Milwaukees are tasting okay tonight.
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
Who plays Jacqueline Onassis? Jackie O.
In JFK?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know if it's anyone off the top of my head. I don't think she's really featured in there.
Okay.
Excuse me. There may be a an actress that played her, but I don't think she has a speaking role or anything like that. And from what I remember... I don't know that there was necessarily anyone that really even played
Kennedy.
JFK. Yeah.
Just a grainy mock-up of the Zapruder film.
Right. They showed a lot of Zapruder stuff. Yeah. But remember when that movie came out?
Yeah, it was huge.
How, I mean, this is kind of a scary thing. First of all.
Well, Trump should have released everything.
He should have. He should have done a lot of things. He should have done a lot of things and he didn't. Here's what I got to say about JFK. JFK came out in 1991, and I was, you know, a younger guy. I wasn't a guy. I was a kid. But
I was a man.
Yeah. I'll just say real quick from what I remember about it and then let Bubs take over here because he was a little older and more mature. I remember it being everywhere. You couldn't escape it. Everyone was talking about it. TV shows were talking about it. They were making parodies of it. And politicians were talking about it. They got legislation passed. Something to do with assassination legislation where, you know, you're going to turn over this, this, and this in this type of time frame. And it sounds like it, they still don't go about that stuff. I think it's like they have to turn it over unless they can articulate a reason why. And it seems like this JFK stuff should have been open by now, and it never is.
Well, it's 60 years.
Right. So obviously, I think they're waiting for the right type of people to die so they don't get, you know, sandbagged and buried or something like that. I'm not really sure.
Man, I don't know who's left.
I don't know. Probably people in Congress who knew what was going on and didn't say anything. You know, the Pelosi's, the fucking Chuck Schumer's.
They don't know.
Well, I mean, they've been in power since the 80s.
But they, you know, they weren't a part of that 50s into the 60s mechanism that caused that violent overthrow.
They were there when this legislation was passed in 91 or 92, though.
Sure, sure.
The only thing that I didn't, before, I won't, like, taint the whole movie review with it, but there's a scene in there where Oliver Stone takes a great, 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 great liberty with kind of showing the viewer, injecting the viewer with his sort of bizarre fucking opinion. Which was that LBJ had a hand in, you know, signing off on Kennedy and Vietnam and everything else after that. So,
well, it's, you know, I guess who knows? Most of the people are dead.
Right.
It probably was not a single shooter from the book depository.
Do you think it was more than one?
Well, look how his head snaps.
I still think it was one. I think Lee Harvey Oswald shot and killed Kennedy alone because he was nuts. And I think Jack Ruby, who was also nuts, shot and killed Oswald alone because he was nuts. I think that there's probably some information that's fucked up.
Leah Harvey Oswald was in the Soviet Union.
Yeah, he was.
And he was down in Mexico meeting with these fucks.
He's nuts.
Yeah, but...
he wanted to be a communist.
Come on.
The only thing that I think is somewhat strange for me, I think there is something going on, but I don't think it was three or four guys firing at him from one position or one guy in a tower and two guys here and two guys there. I still think it was one dude who was fucked up. Oswald tried doing it to a general.
Yeah.
You know, a little bit before that,
yeah.
He had a history of trying to assassinate heads of, you know, political figures.
But somebody was handling him.
Do you think someone was handling him when they told them to fire on this general?
Yeah, that was a test run.
Okay. I mean, plausible.
And then I guess you have to look at what that general stood for. Was he anti-Vietnam?
Not really sure myself. It's a good point, though. The one thing that I think is strange is I think the J.D. Tippett thing, the policeman who Oswald shot and killed, that one's a little bit more okay. Some people have floated the idea that Tippett was then sent to murder Oswald, and Oswald got the drop on him and, you know, took him out first. There you might have a little bit of something, like you could kind of catch my attention a little bit. But
I don't know.
All the other stuff about Soviets and foreign governments, that should have come out by now from foreign governments.
Well, maybe it was all internal. And they just created a patsy that they could fucking throw everything on, but then they just put him out there at the scene, whether he was firing bullets or not, probably.
I do know this much. The JFK movie review is a really good call, and we're going to have a great discussion about this once we know more.
Yeah, this is going to be a full show.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm going to have notes.
The one reason that I'm a little bit more sort of non-conspiratorial on this one, even though I am on a lot of other stuff, is there's a book by Vince Bugliosi.
Yeah. Is that the guy that did Helter Skelter?
Yes.
And that's a tainted view of Manson.
Some people think so, yeah.
Yeah.
But that view got Manson convicted. The Helter Skelter scenario got him convicted.
Sure.
Bugliosi basically goes through every little piece of minutia. It's a 2,000-page book. I think it was the last book he wrote before he died. And that is the ultimate sort of compendium, I think, on the JFK assassination.
And where did he, real quickly, where did he fall on it?
He thought, for the most part, it was a real set of unfortunate circumstances and single shooters and mentally ill people that eventually were... they didn't come out with information in a timely manner. They hid information, and that is what breeds conspiracy theory.
Sure.
Taking out a president is a very difficult thing to do, even in the early 60s. I think still, and I'm going to get fucking flamed for it, I still think it was one guy. Sorry.
It's a point. Single bullet theory.
I also remember...
with one undamaged bullet that was found on his gurney.
There's,
so that's back to JFK.
Bullets are undamaged all the time. You know this, and I know this. You've seen Full Metal Jacket bullets get fired from weapons, go downrange, smack into some dirt, some sand, ricochet off something. There it
President's is. President's head, arm.
Maybe it wasn't his head.
Didn't Conley get hit?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
They wasn't Conley's reaction before?
I don't know.
Kennedy's?
I don't. That According one I don't know. These are all questions for another one.
We're going to be in depth.
We're going to be on a big series of shows here.
If it's hot like this, I'm going to have to get a fucking headband.
I'm a skeptic. Bubs sometimes isn't. Sometimes he is. I love and cherish Bubs and his opinion. So just because today we don't agree on the magic bullet or MacGruber.
That's right. I think it's the heat.
How about we take this moment to hear from our new sponsor?
Yeah, all right, let's do that. Today's episode is brought to you by Full Force Condoms, a condom for the modern male made with patented synthetic rubber for a flawless fit and flawless performance when that time arises. Use Full Force Condom. Let's see, endorsed by the French Foreign Legion and the Nebraska Division of Corrections. Full Force Condoms. Found at any drug emporium and truck stop, when nothing but full force will do.
Excellent. Bubs, one question. Do they come in additional sizes?
Oh, yeah, there's sizes. I mean, there's, you know, various, according to the stuff I read and what they sent you, I mean, there's different textures, different, sure. you know, add-ons and thicknesses.
Great.
So it's
great.
Based on personal preference and use. So I'd like to thank that sponsor for stepping up. And obviously you're, you know, hopefully can experiment and give us a little feedback on
I'm looking forward to them, yes.
Full force condom.
Great. Mm-hmm. While we're at it, why don't we also hear from our other sponsor, turn it over to Baby G.
Real men have a real thirst. That's why I only serve genuine ice-cold Old Milwaukee beer to my men. It always satisfies. Old Milwaukee beer for that wonderful world of leisure.
That was fantastic. Thank you so much for those words from our sponsors, especially the classic Old Milwaukee, but also the new kid in town, Full Force Condoms, when nothing but full force will do.
And, guess what? I mean, you got a six-pack, you know, or a 12-er, and you got a pocket full of condoms.
They kind
of
go hand in hand, don't they?
Hand in hand, just watch the whiskey dance.
What else do I need? Just an 8-ball of Coke and my set of car keys, I guess.
Right. And some bad choices.
Yeah.
But that, you know
that,
what?
That fog hat tape.
Fool for the city and rap that rascal.
I got to say this.
I have that album.
Full Force. Those guys are going places.
Yeah.
We got to see if we got to look them up on X.
Well, I guess if the French Foreign Legion is using them, I mean, they travel the world over to commit war and atrocities. So
travel the world and elsewhere.
Yeah. Yes. And, you know, if you got to rape and pillage, use a Full Force.
And when you're done with all that raping and pillaging, it's time to kick back for that wonderful world of leisure.
And how about Old Milwaukee?
Bubs, I got to ask you a question. As a guy who's, you know, been on this earth a little longer than me, what would you say the breeze and wind speed is right now here at the studio?
1 mile an hour.
I mean, zero, right?
Yeah,
nothing is moving.
Negligible. It's getting thicker as we look out the window.
God, I'm hot.
Ah, it's the humidity. Right. It's not a dry heat. When I have, for me personally, and I know this is a milestone or a checkpoint for me personally, when I have sweat on my shins, then I know it's humid out. And that's a condition for me.
That's a good one, huh?
Yeah, that's when I look down and I see, you know, condensation and sweat on my shin, then I know we're in for a sticky one. Why?
Because it's too fucking hot.
It's part of the simulation. That's what you got to go through. Are you an NPC?
No, but we've been talking about the simulation shit for a while and how we're going to touch on it. And we're finally going to now in this sweltering studio of ours. But the simulation, basically, the simulation hypothesis or simulation theory, thought experiments like this have been around forever. In a way.
But isn't it like, you know, became popular after The Matrix came out?
Kind of. Yeah. Right? Kind of. But I mean, even going back to antiquities.
Ooh. Who are we talking at? Well, Aristotle?
Like Plato. He had, I believe it was Plato who had something called the cave, where it was, you had one group of people that were outside the cave, where it was sunny, and they were playing, and they were enjoying life for all it is. Then you have another group of people who are inside the cave and they're facing a cave wall and there's a fire behind them and all they get to see is shadows of people playing outside the cave. To those people, the cave wall is reality. Even though reality in and of itself is what's occurring outside of the cave.
Well, isn't reality just a dependent upon the position in which you're standing?
Probably.
Right.
Yeah, I guess so. And maybe that's, I haven't read the entire cave thing by Plato, but I know that that's kind of the gist of it.
General relativity.
The kind of modern simulation hypothesis, and just for everyone who's listening, some of you guys are going to be a lot smarter than me. If I'm getting this stuff wrong, feel free to, you know, mention it all you want. But I'm going to try to give you broad strokes on this one because it's kind of an interesting thing. For the most part, the kind of modern interpretation of it or the modern sort of question comes from a paper written by a guy named Nick Bostrom or Bostrom. I'm not sure exactly how you pronounce it. I believe he's from either German or Swiss or Swedish. Take your pick, I guess. He wrote a paper in 2003. This guy's a scholar and professor and whatever else, called Are You Living in a Computer Simulation? This was published in something called Philosophical Quarterly. Bostrom is basically arguing that there's a good chance that human beings, maybe even me or you or Nick Bostrom himself or Bubs or anyone, are living inside a computer simulation. And the way he sort of frames it is, someday in the future, there may be enough technology available for humans to load people's brains or the memories that they have in their brains into some type of a computer, if you will. Now, it's probably not going to be a computer that we're used to kind of playing with. It's not going to be a laptop. It's not going to be a PC. It's not even going to be a supercomputer that takes place.
So it's going to be an organic?
Maybe, yeah. Possibly. But it's going to be some type of a computer. And he goes into, you know, speculate on, first of all, for something like this to work, several things need to be in place. One, humans need to be able to eventually get to a point where they can take memories and data on a human brain and put it into some sort of computer interface.
Sure.
Where instead of just a walking living person, now this these memories are sitting on type of a some type of a disk space or something like that. He referred to it as substrate or something like that. This is, we're very far away, at least to my knowledge, from getting there. Secondly, the computer technology needs to be of such an advanced state that they need to be able to perform what they, these numbers are so large that they're even beyond me, but computer technology needs to eventually get to a point. We're not there yet with computing power. As far as I can tell, I don't think we're even close. And this guy figured too that if you had a computer that had the mass of a planet, you might be able to achieve something like this. So would we ever get to a technology sort of point as a society where we could either A, have computers that were that had the mass of a planet, or if we could eventually figure out how quantum computers worked, then we might be able to run stuff that was where you wouldn't have to have a computer that was the mass of a planet. You could have a computer that maybe weighed 2 kilograms, but you could still get just as much, if not more, computing power out of that machine. We're not there. The reason I bring this up is because if that machine were to exist, you could then theoretically take the brain and memories of human beings, real brains, biological brains, and download them or upload them into this substrate or this computer that could then run these computations. At this point, you now have, like, for lack of a better, from what I can gather, you now have a simulation where you could put someone in there and their consciousness is now sort of part of the simulation, and they're walking around and they're, the people around him are also simulated. The setting around him is simulated. When he goes to the store, it's simulated. When he goes and leaves his house in the morning, it's simulated. Everything is a simulation and nothing is real, even though it seems real.
But at first, humanity has to survive long enough to create this.
They have to get to a point that he likes to refer to as post-human.
Well, okay, that's arguing the fact that the back in antiquity, as you said earlier, didn't happen. Maybe with technology that happened a long, long time ago. And we could argue that our planet is 4 billion years old. Well, in the last 100 million years, maybe that technology has risen, collapsed, and risen, and collapsed, and risen, and collapsed. And now we are a product of the simulation that happened 10 million years ago.
Sure.
That's a possibility.
It is. Man, it's hard to wrap your head around these fucking things. It really is. That one too, Bubs, is interesting.
But then some people argue that the fact that our universe has strict rules of physics, right? Like video games have strict rules within them to operate.
Yes.
So our universe, according to us, has strict rules that we know about. Gravity, E equals MC squared. I mean, I'm using a layman's idiot terms for this stuff, but
sure. Right?
And so you can go with the speed of light, can transmit data at the speed of light, and that's a restriction. There is no faster speed. So we are restricted to the speed of light.
Perhaps the programmers put in a governor of some sort.
The speed of light. So it's a measure, and that's it. That's as far as we
that I have heard.
Yeah.
Here basically is kind of what this guy also is saying. And this is kind of, this is actually his words from the very like sort of preface.
Before you get real serious with that, is there a porn site on this simulation that I can go to for maybe a small monthly fee?
Okay,
so, get back to your serious right.
So
talk
this paper argues that at least one of the following propositions is true, and there's three of them. One, the human species is very likely to go extinct before reaching a post-human stage. That's one. Two, any post-human civilization is extremely unlikely to run a significant number of simulations of their evolutionary history or variations thereof. Mm-hmm. So, I'll just go all of them. Three, we are almost certainly living in a computer simulation. It follows that the belief that there is a significant chance that we will one day become post-humans who run ancestor simulations is false unless we are currently living in a simulation. A number of other consequences of this result are also discussed. So basically what he's saying is, of the three sort of propositions, one, the human species is very likely to go extinct before reaching post-human. Post-human is supportive... supposedly kind of that moment where we're smart enough where we could build computers that are big as planets, or we could upload someone's biological brain into a digital format and be able to observe their memories. That's what post-human is. What he's saying there is that it's likely we're never even going to get to that point. We'll go extinct before that.
I would agree with that theory.
I would too.
Yeah.
That for me, this thing is all the most dystopian fucking bullshit. It's really, if you have any sort, I don't care if you're Christian or Muslim or Jewish or whatever, this is like, what he's saying in part two is basically, let's say you get to the post-human stage.
Well, you know what'll happen, don't you? Once in the post-human stage?
What?
Apes will rise up. I've seen the movie. three of those.
Is that
movies.
Soylent Green at that point?
No, come on.
Same guy though.
Charlton
right?
Heston.
Yeah,
let's go.
He was Soylent Green though, right?
Well, he was. Yes.
Part two: any post-human civilization. So they've gotten to that point. Once they have the technology, though, they're extremely unlikely to run with the technology. I think that's false. You give someone a nuclear weapon and then tell them, don't ever touch this. Well, somebody's going to touch it.
Well, you touched something close.
What's that?
We touched a big bomb twice.
We did?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, we touched it once before we even touched it, you know, for real, just to make sure we could set it off.
Let's touch this.
Right.
I think the first time I touched myself, I then touched myself again.
Probably shortly thereafter.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey,
sure.
What was this I just discovered?
That's a bomb.
And then three is, okay, we're living in a computer simulation now because if you ever got to the level where you could attain the technology that was necessary to run simulations that were that good, if you attained that technology, that meant that you were sure to use it as a species or as a civilization. And if you were sure to use it, that means that right now, how do we know whether we're real or fake? And that's where I have the real problem of, dude, I mean, come on. We're real. if we're possibly fake, why don't you just get on your knees right now and we'll start hitting you with objects and you can tell us if, you know what I mean? I don't think that, to me, this came out in 2003. The Matrix came out in 1999.
Mm-hmm.
This guy was probably in his mid-20s when The Matrix came out.
Then jerked off many times right. while watching Neo.
Right. And this dude, too.
Well, they come up with the philosophy. I mean, Elon Musk even talks about this. What's his name? Nick Bostrom?
Elon thinks that it's very possible that that's happening right now.
Well, okay.
From what I understand, he basically says, what do you think? I mean, you don't believe him or what?
Elon?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, he can think what he thinks. He's just expanding and commenting on this other guy's theory. All this is modern day philosophy.
What
is our existence?
What did Elon say about Bostrom?
Well, no, he just, I don't have any quotes, but he just supported Nick Bostrom's view on how it could be a game simulation or something, or how it would evolve to that.
I agree 100% with you that this is basically guys who are kind of the Socrates and philosophers, or, you know, maybe they're.
But maybe the simulation handicaps us with only our, you know, some parts of society can look at history and say, okay, planet's 4 billion years old. At this point, dinosaurs showed up. At this point, you know, this happens. Mammals take over. Dinosaurs are extinct. Okay. But then there's another portion of our existence for a long time that believed the Earth was only 5,000 years old.
Yes.
Going back to creation in the Bible. And then those stories. So, you know, maybe that's just part of the simulation. So for a long time, people couldn't grasp the depth of history and the eons and eons and billions of years. A billion years is inconceivable to our modern mind. To a mind, you can't conceive of a billion years.
True.
You can write it on, you could talk about it, but you cannot conceive that time.
No, I don't think so either. I mean, it's hard to, I'm 44. When I think back to when I was 14, it seems like it wasn't the same.
But time and the way we view time. We view time linear, right? So what was time 100,000 or 2 million years ago? How do you view time? It was seasonal. It was daylight. It was night. I mean, you weren't punching a clock. It wasn't minutes, seconds, hours, days, weeks. It's just you just existed. If you go on a camping trip for a long-ass time and live out in the bush for... I would say after 4 or 5 days, even time is irrelevant.
I would think it would.
The natural cycles of life take over.
The basis for time at that point would probably be somewhere along the
circadian rhythms.
9 months. Well, yeah, that you're going to bed when the sun goes down and awaking when it comes up. Or I would think another constant would be a child, you know, a woman gets pregnant, 9 months later, the baby comes out type thing, regardless of sort of who you are, where you are on the planet.
Yeah. Yeah. There's consistence that the patterns that start to show and people started keeping track of patterns.
Yes.
So patterns then create time.
Eventually they discovered that there's 24 hours before, you know, the same thing starts to happen again.
Yeah.
And then there's 365 days before we're back at the same spot that we were a quote-unquote year ago.
According to the machine in the sky.
Right. What's your 2 cents, though, Bubs, on... I obviously kind of gave mine. I like listening and reading to guys like this, to stuff like this, but this one to me is just too weird.
They look for, how people or us ignorant people look at it is, well, there's a glitch in the system. So, people argue about the Mandela effect. So people will say that a commercial from 1985 that is played nowadays is played differently, or the words are different in it than it was in 1985, and that's the Mandela effect.
Yep.
And what they say, or they use Mandela, the rebel from South Africa that eventually became the president, that he died in the 80s. You know, they said he died in the 80s, and then all of a sudden, no, he's back and he's alive, and then history changed because of that. So it's the Mandela effect. So certain things that, I look back upon, and I'm just speculating, I'll look at a Pepsi commercial that I recall and remember, or have the video of it on a VHS, and if somebody else plays that same commercial, it's different nowadays. That's called the Mandela effect, and then they say that's like a glitch in the system.
Yeah. I remember Nelson Mandela pretty vividly as a younger person, mainly because when I was in junior high and high school, well, junior high mostly, Mandela was talked about because I think he was getting out of prison finally after they South Africa abolished apartheid. I know what the Mandela effect is. I'm one of those people, though, where that never hit me the way that did. I remember Nelson Mandela dying in 2013 or 2012 or whenever it was, and I never remembered it as he died in the 80s. I remember he got out of prison in, I think, the late 80s, and then was, you know, elected president in...
sometime in the 90s.
I think in the early 90s, maybe.
I don't know. So we're done with simulation, or are we still
Kind of. Like, it's...
Where's the sex part? Because technology only advances through war and sex.
How does technology advance through sex?
Porn. Porn made the internet go. Porn makes the videos on the internet. Porn changes how the speed of computing happens. War changes technology. War advances technology. Porn pushes it forward for the masses.
That's going to be a great soundbite, Bubs.
Okay, well, it's true.
You're profound. That's actually that's absolutely true. Yeah, porno more or less did build the internet.
So what you need to do right now is look where is porn going in 5 years? Where is porn? Where is the sex industry going in 10 years? You know, are you going to order up a robot at home? Not your vacuum, but some fucking thing, and right? You're going to have a doll.
Here's what you're going to do.
Slow dance with her and put on your full force condom.
When nothing else will do, full force comes through.
No coming through.
yeah, good point.
Coming through. Yeah. No coming through.
We're on to something there, though, with the tagline.
Yeah, when nothing but full force will do.
Yeah. Am I done with the simulation thing? A little. I mean, there's way more to go on this, but it's honestly... It's too advanced for my tiny little brain.
It is advanced, and honestly, okay.
It's bullshit. It's not true.
We're in a simulation. What are we going to do, crack the code? Is somebody going to show up and all of a sudden know kung fu and hand us a blue or red pill? No, it's not going to happen.
Right.
So we exist in what we exist in, which I believe in kind of a realist point of view. I believe our creator created us. I live within those means, and I will do the best I can.
I do, too. You guys can't see this. But right now, I'm holding that 14-page thesis paper in my hand. And there it goes, Bubs.
Right into the wheelbarrow.
Right in the fucking trash where it belongs.
Fuck it.
I believe that the world is beautiful and terrifying at the same time.
As it should be.
I believe that it's difficult to get ahead. And I believe that believing in something like that is really just an excuse to keep someone from being productive. Philosophers can, that's what they get paid for. So go ahead and do that all the live long fucking day. But somebody going back to Plato's times, you know, 2000 years ago had the same idea.
There's one philosopher that nailed it. Diogenes, right? The cynic.
He was great.
Masturbated in public, lived in a barrel, drank out of puddles.
Lived in a wine barrel, was very smart and, walked around nude, went to the bathroom where he wanted.
Questioned everything.
Yep. And to me, this guy, not unlike, you know, probably, I'm guessing just a really, really, really intelligent homeless bum that hated to conform. Yeah, you know what I mean? Like he had it together.
Well, then you wonder, was it a real person or was somebody just writing about something that they wanted to be?
Diogenes? Yeah. I bet he was probably, I mean, I'm guessing there's more than one account.
I mean, it's like you or I sitting on the corner, let's say in downtown Minneapolis, watching the guy scream at the wall and then follow him around for a week and then decide to write about him. And then, oh, you know what? I'm gonna put a big middle finger up to philosophers and claim this guy is the shit.
Did Diogenes ever have any writings that survived?
Well, I think it's somebody else writing about him. I don't think he was, didn't seem to fit his character that he wrote. But, I mean, he was, lived with, God, I can't remember the guy's Greek name, something with a T, but whatever. But, yeah, you know, it's an interesting story. It's an interesting point of view. I think he had a so-called run-in, you know, a run-in with Alexander the Great where he, you know, he said something to him and then he said, well, you're blocking my son.
Yeah, yeah, Right, where Alexander was like doing some, he was like walking through town like with pomp and circumstance or something like that, and Diogenes nude and probably covered in piss and God knows what else in his wine barrel.
Yeah. And then he had, you know, something about the bones, you know, where they'd throw the bones, you know, over the sidewall or, you know, something on the outskirts of town. And then he just, you know, all I see is princes or something, you know. So it didn't, in the end, it doesn't matter who you were in life. We all end up in the same, you know, earth, dead.
Is it safe to say that you and I have today debunked simulation theory on the Bubs in the Bagger show?
I don't know if we've debunked it, but we've said fuck it.
Yeah.
Fuck a waste these of time. People.
We're on Team Diogenes.
Yeah.
Interesting thing I realized, you ever heard of Diogenes syndrome?
What's that?
Also known as senile squalor syndrome.
Okay.
Is a disorder characterized by extreme self-neglect, domestic squalor, social withdrawal, apathy, compulsive hoarding of garbage or animals, and a lack of shame. This is sounding... Oh, this one's hitting a little close to home, Bubs.
Yeah. Let me walk through your house one more time and take a closer look. Are those hamsters alive?
My 19 hamsters and my garbage and my complete don't-give-a-fuck attitude. Affected people may also display symptoms of catatonia, which I believe is...
Catatonic. That's like staring at the floor.
You don't realize what's going on around you?
Well, yeah, you're just checked out and you're staring at the floor.
Gotcha.
And you may be doing that for 2 days in a row or something.
Condition was first recognized in 1966.
In a movie in the 1930s or 40s or 50s, a man would slap a woman who was catatonic to get her back to reality.
Yeah.
And then have a cigarette.
God damn it, Shirley. Snap out of it.
Slap, slap.
I'm sorry, Carl. I'll have your Salisbury steak on the table in 3 minutes. I don't know what came over me.
Pour the whiskey.
That's right. So the name derives from Diogenes of Sinope, an ancient Greek philosopher, a cynic, and an ultimate minimalist who allegedly lived in a large jar in Athens. Not only did he not hoard, but he actually sought human company by venturing daily into agora. Therefore, the eponym is considered to be a misnomer. So they kind of just named the disorder after him, even though it didn't have a whole lot.
Well, is that agoraphobia, where you don't leave your house?
Yeah.
So yeah. All right. So he turned it around on it.
I'm a big fan of that one.
When, you don't want to leave your house?
When lockdowns came out, I was, I don't want to be a government stooge here, but if you're going to tell me to stay home, well, fine, twist my arm.
That was the opposite.
Really?
Yeah. Went to work every day. We had parties. We had a speakeasy. Mm. It was fuck 2020 party. That was the code word to get into the garage. And we had a drink, a 1920s drink named after an actress. And then...
A Greta Garbo?
No, it was like a Myrna something. I can't remember her name, but it was okay. I had pictures of it prepped and people would come in. I'd pour them a drink and they'd go inside. And we probably had 30 people at our house.
That sounds like actually... quite a rager.
I put a red light out over the door.
Yeah.
Yep.
Knock three times and say
with your cane,
word.
Rap once. Word. Yeah. Come on in. Have a drink. No masks.
That was a bit.
I'm moist AF. Should have wore that shirt.
That's what the kids are saying?
Moist AF. That's what the kids say.
Dude. I'm into some of these shirts that the kids are wearing, but not all of them. You know what I mean? They kind of dress a little bit different for me today.
Like what?
I don't know. I mean, it just seems a little thrown together.
Yeah, So I work out at any time, like we covered earlier. And there's some cat in there. He's, I don't know, probably maybe 21, 22 at the most. He's always in there with his girlfriend. He's relatively jacked, but he's not on anything. And I saw him and he was wearing a Kiss shirt. And so I walk up to him. I'm like, dude, you a Kiss fan? I just got the shirt. I'm like, that's fine. I said, why don't you listen to a little Kiss or something, you know, while you're working out? So at least he can back it up. And he's like, oh, yeah, I will. And then the other day I saw him wearing a 1979 Van Halen tour shirt. So I was like, are you a Van Halen fan? And he just gave me the up nod, wouldn't talk to me.
No shit.
Mm-hmm. Because he knows I was going to go after him about, you know, can you name
right.
four Van Halen songs?
Name one Van Halen song, maybe even. I mean,
for a guy that age?
Well, 79 era, I would say like maybe Dance the Night Away.
Jamie's Crying.
Yeah. Boy.
Eruption.
Listen, there's a fan of the show. He's a big fan, actually. Guy by the name of Beesh. That guy was hitting me up in the DMs the other day talking mm-hmm. to me about early Van Halen. We had a real good discussion about that. We brought up both those songs.
Yeah.
So good call on
Atomic Punk.
Yeah. Eruption, I think, was on one of them too, right?
Well, that's Van Halen 1. That was one of the first albums I ever bought.
Eruption must have been so cool to hear for the first time as a kid.
Yeah. My parents probably heard it 400 times. I don't think they thought it was as cool because they were the class of 59.
And then it goes into You Really Got Me,
yeah.
or whatever.
Yeah,
the
Kinks.
Yeah, the cover song.
Yeah.
Man, that's a great album. Excuse us while we hydrate.
Well, Diamond David Lee Roth was obviously a quintessential showman in the front.
Maybe one of the best frontmen.
I mean, like it's
maybe,
be.
Maybe
his
number
persona,
one.
Yeah. I mean, who else was strutting around? Mick Jagger, I guess, in those days.
Yeah, that's a good point. I mean,
Roger Daltrey.
I mean, Daltrey, yeah.
Those guys were doing movies and rock operas, and, you know, he had his on. I saw The Who.
For me, David Lee Roth, I think, kind of like takes the frontman concept to like, he's the one who popularized, like, without David Lee Roth, I don't think like Motley Crue blows up like that. Mainly because, like, even though Jagger is obviously like the quintessential frontman, was he as in your face as David Lee Roth with the quips and the, you know, talking about,
yeah.
you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
it was just
hey,
a little bit
man.
Different.
Yeah, the surfer vibe
Jagger
guy.
Was more like, hey, man, okay, guys, please, would you
yeah,
just,
but,
just cool out?
But at that point, Jagger had been doing it since 1964.
Yep.
You know, so he already had a pretty good run and was a seasoned veteran in the business.
If you watch him at that concert, too, where the Hells Angels were providing security and, yeah. they, and that one guy got shot.
Mm-hmm.
Meredith
did
something?
He get shot or stabbed?
You're right, he got stabbed, but he pulled a pistol.
Yeah, black fella.
Yep, he pulled out a 22.
Yeah,
was going towards the stage. A Hell's Angel came in there and
took care
put
of
him
it.
Down.
Yeah,
yeah. And this was happening during the concert.
Yeah,
and you can see it on the film.
Yeah, and they flee to their helicopters.
Yeah, what was the name of the movie too? It's named after a Stone song, I think.
I don't know, maybe, but it's the Monterey Pop Festival, right?
It was. People consider this more or less along with the Manson murders to be the end of the 60s.
Sure. Yeah.
And mainly because the pop festival went haywire.
Owry.
Yeah. They basically had a massive rock concert that they thought was going to be like Woodstock. Who's this fucking Yahoo?
What is this? One of the fans? One of the fans driving
by. I know, guys.
By.
We're doing a live podcast, but I'm going to have to ask you to just sort of keep your emotions in check here. Otherwise, we're going to have to call the authorities.
We'll have you removed from the simulation.
Whoa.
How come you don't have any whiskey in your house?
Bubs, I'm going to give you a fucking
no,
Old Milwaukee.
No, I don't want an Old Milwaukee. Right. But
how about this?
Why don't you have a... You're a bachelor.
I know.
You're a man of town.
A man of leisure.
And a man of town. Why don't you have a full bar in your house? Why don't you have a bar in your house?
Because... I'm trying to sort of, you know, like save on money a little bit before I do any capital improvements on the property.
Yeah, but you could go a bottle of vodka, bottle of rum, bottle of tequila, couple bottles of fucking gin, and some mixers, and then you have a full bar.
Let me answer that question.
And when you're stumbling in the dark for your full force condom, it'd be nice if, you know, your lady friend had a martini.
You're right, Bubs. I could do all these things. I could have that beautiful bar with all six of those bottles.
You could be the otter.
Yep. Oh. You could be otter. Yeah.
You could be otter. The otter of...
Marlene Desmond. You're going to pork Marlene. Yeah. I don't have it because it's a little too tempting. And all those bottles staring at me at that bar that one night when I come home. Hmm. Well, that's like staring Bubs
into
a mirror of despair.
Temptation. And,
it talks to me at that point, and all I want to do...
So you'd rather just sit and eat your vanilla ice cream with a little chocolate on it and just cry?
Just get a little sad.
Yeah,
and,
maybe a little Debbie.
Yep, and watch Beaches. And then right into the fudge rounds.
Yeah. Oh, yes, yes.
And then, you know, and then just softly cry myself to sleep. Yeah. That's my idea of a great Saturday. You're right. I do need a bar here. What if, I mean, we're at about...
I'm going to, the next time I show up here, I'm going to have a in-house supply for myself.
No problem.
Yeah. So I'm kind of like... I'm like the actor or the band that shows up, the talent that has to have certain things in their contract.
Okay.
And I need a bottle of Jim Beam, a tumbler glass, and access to ice.
A rider. A tour rider, basically.
I need that in my contract. So we're going to have to negotiate, or I'll just force it upon you.
I'll tell you what. What if we wrap this one up?
If you came to my house, would you be able to have a cocktail of almost any choice?
Yes.
Okay.
Almost any, including a beer.
So, as a person that's been on the earth a little longer than you, you get to work.
I'll take care of it. Yeah. Next time I'll have something for you.
Yeah.
Excellent show today. I'm glad we debunked simulation theory. I'm glad we threw it exactly where it needs to be. We also had a very polarizing argument today about MacGruber.
Mm. $4.99 is what you fucking owe me.
Right. It's going to come because here's what I'm going to do for you. On your way out of town, I'm going to buy you that shot of Jim Beam.
Okay.
That'll cost roughly $4.99. Mm. And then we're going to be even. And
will they let me in the bar without a shirt on?
I got a shirt if you want one.
They ain't going to fit.
A dry one.
Fit.
I got 2X.
Yeah, ain't going to fit.
Dude, we're not that far off, buddy. Yeah. I'm just a little bit taller, that's all.
Hmm. Okay.
This build that you see that you
What size sport coat do you purchase?
I would say probably a 40 long.
Okay. So mine's a 52 short.
No shit, huh?
No shit. So we're a little off.
Not really. It's just long and short at that point. I mean, you're just a little bigger in the neck.
And you know what can support long and short? Full force condoms.
But thanks, everyone, today for sticking with us in one of the hottest days and most humid days in the studio that I've ever had. I know that by the time you hear this, it probably won't be that same weather, but thanks anyway. It was a brutal one in here today. We had a lot of fun. We're going to be back in a few more days for you. Thanks for listening. We appreciate all the support. Bubs, what else do you have to say? Anything?
Today was a sack stretcher and a breast sweater.
Yes.
Yes. Under the breast.
Thanks again, guys. We're going to see you next time, all right? Thanks for listening.
I'm out.